Hi, and welcome back to our Open Stop Motion film project. I hope everyone had a good Easter, and I will. I took a week more so I could get in front with something. As you can see here, I have a lot of things I need to get finished, and I'm gotten to the state in the process where I need to kind of tightening up the loose ends I have. I keep on doing stuff and then go on to the next and next and next and next, and some of it I don't finish because I try to make it as best possible to look at, but that's when I'm only one guy, it's very difficult to make it as interesting as I want it to be for those few that are watching it. So, but I'm trying. But now I have to finish some of it, and I have to start building the landscape, the wood, where it all have to be, and where the story in the film is. So I have a lot of you can see back in your view back with the big tree. There's a lot of trees laying there, and they are not finished. And there's under the table, there's much more trees, and you cannot see from here, but there's some other half finished tree other as in other places. And then I have these clay ones I have to finish too. And as you can see on the table in front here with the green tree, I have tried to figure out how I can make leaves quicker than just applying one leaf at the time, because there I have to make hundreds of them. So I have been experimenting with ways to do that, and I think I have found the solutions to make it quicker, in the same way that I found solutions to get around the part where when I have to scan something, I made a lot of crosses on the one cross at a time on the clay figure, because that was giving the best result. But I found another solution where I can do it in minutes, and so, but you will see that later, not today, but on a later time. But that was a good thing. But I have unfinished business, and this guy was one of them. As you remember, I had to print some feet to him last I saw you, and the episode you saw just before I put this on, we started a live broadcast here. I was building this one, and I built him on a wooden frame like this, so I could manage him. And this is a cormorant, so, and the cormorant had feet like a duck. It's a seabird, so, but it can sit in trees too. I have seen that, but, and they are living in trees, but sometimes they are a little clumsy in trees because of the kind of feet they have. So I made this one, and to get him printed, I need to put this on instead of this, so I can make him real. And I have a lot of other birds and animals of all different kinds, so we need to make one thing at a time. So not to keep on doing make more and more and more loose ends, I have to tighten it up a little. I have some sandpaper here, and before I mount it, I have to clean it up a little. You can see if it will focus on it, it's a little rough. So this part will be, what do we call it? Hidden up in his body. There will not be more out. And it's hard to do it like this. This part will be up there, and then you can see, but you'll see that later. But first I will try to clean this up a little. So I will do that. I'll go get a knife and something. Where do I have that? Maybe I should okay, I have to change the preference of this. Okay, I don't need to have live. I need to take this bit down here so I can this a little. And I will move this down a little here so you can see what I'm doing. And it, as you know, is this is a little noisy. I'll change the tip on this one here. Like this. So. And I always place the mouse on the toolbox, and then I cannot get in the toolbox. That's not smart. So, new tip.
Thank you. So
you will go to the other room. Back. And we are back. And we will put this down a little and move this away. And let's get closer, a little longer down. I will not remove this part of it before after I have printed when I have mounted this wood on him, then I make a 3D print, a scanning of him, and then make a 3D print of the bird, because it's very big here. But always try to make it as nice as possible. Oops! In every part of the way. So and this here are really hard to sand in. But it's easier to sand it now than later when it's up in the clay, because the clay gets hot while I'm doing it, so it ending up dragging it out, pull it out when I have, because of the clay are a little heavy. But it was nice with a little Easter occasion. We were in a summer cabin. Had a lot of fun with the grandchildren and the children and whatnot. Some good eating and that kind of stuff. But it was raining the most of the time, so I have hoped to get out and take a lot of pictures, but that was not really suited for that. But no more vacation before the summer vacation. So there's at least 3 months before that, so I think this is good enough just for scan. Then when I have scanned it and printed it, then we have to do it really nice. Now we need to remove this. Because that's not like what a bird look like. I need some tools. And where is that? Okay. I think it's over here. I will get, there it is. You are running around and placing the stuff everywhere. See. We have filled up the, maybe you can't see it yet, but you can in a little while. See, he's hollow inside because I wanted to avoid the heavy weight that will be in him if we just, it was clay, all of it, but now we have a problem to get this one inside. So we need to cut a little, and we do that with this. Oh, is this too heavy? We can't. Come on. There it was. Let's see, cardboard. It's a roll from a paper kitchen towel. Obviously, there's more than cardboard inside here, I think. Oops! So, see? Where the this stand we can use on another one when we are building them. So it don't disappear too much. Shall we see? Well, it went a little bit more. This. This is pretty much how we want him to look. Tilted like this. How does that look? It's a very funny and very smart bird, this cormorant. I like. I know a lot of fishermen that hate them because they're stealing their catch, their fish in the net. Why fish yourself when you can get someone to do it for you? And that's what they, depending on some time. But I think that's smart. At least for a bird. Was in that. Need to get all the plastic stuff out of the away from the table because you have it in everywhere later. So because now I think this is more or less ready for scan and print. Plastic in any everywhere now. Never sand the same place that you are working with clay. And this, it is that kind of bird that there's some, it looks very old and historic. It looks quite apart from all other birds. I think I will hear what there is on Twitter today.
They made the keys larger and they made the gaps between them smaller, so you can miss hit them. It's not just it's a bigger target area, but that it's a flatter surface area, so that if you miss hit it by a little bit, it still feels like you hit it dead center, and it really gives you a sense of confidence. I had this thought that absolutely didn't occur to me until I started using it, that I can't believe I'm saying
always
this, but Apple
good
to get
thing
rid of
to learn something while you're working
and just go with haptics and give that sort of little sensation. I could sort of see that working, because when I move from tapping the trackpad, which does not have a key switch, to an actual key that actually does have a key switch, it's
and,
hard for my
there's
brain
so many
to
good podcasts out there.
So I'm not saying I'm asking for a keyboard.
And
like
Twit
this,
is one of the best,
mind, so
in my opinion, when it comes to tech.
I completely agree with you on that point. That's actually the first thing I thought of when I was handling it during the hands-on area, during the March event, where it definitely feels like they're getting closer and closer to the idea of experimenting with no keyboard at all, but taking Force Touch technology and maybe transplanting it over. Based on, again, the hoodoo magic that Force Touch trackpad employees, I can envision, I don't know if the future is coming in 2 years or coming in 10 years, but I can definitely envision a point where the haptics technology allows you, as you brush your fingers across an otherwise smooth surface, if there's supposed to be a keyboard there, you get little tactical, not even buzzes so much, but it feels like you have individual keys, and then as you press down, it feels like you're pressing a key. Like, I could see that happening.
Or a piano.
Yeah. Or, I mean, there are lots of avenues for that to work if you open it up to third-party apps.
Now, do you think it would work better if it's now just a glass screen that basically virtualizes whatever control you want? Or do you think you'd rather still have the notebook form factor, only you have this sort of space gray rectangle that is
get a lot of clay into this,
but can also be a game controller if you want?
Yeah, I don't think the pre-printing is necessarily a good idea, because it does limit it to a certain extent. But at the same time, I'm not sure that I want, like, obviously haptics are coming to the iPad. It's going to happen. I don't know if it's going to happen this year, but it's going to happen. But do we want an iPad that still the keyboard takes up half of the screen, and then you're limited to that little narrow window on a potential future laptop? I don't know about that. I'm not quite sure if getting rid of the form factor is the answer. Especially also you think about you think about artists and you think about things like the Wacom tablets and the Cintiq, part of the appeal of for artists and for musicians and things like that is to work tactically directly with your environment and with whatever you have on the screen. But I feel like that differs from profession to profession. Artists want to draw directly on their screens, and they don't necessarily want a substitute if they can avoid it. Whereas someone like a musician might want that full-size screen for their music and then want the second screen or the haptic surface to play their instrument. We're talking such future tech right now that it's really exciting to me. But I can't predict where Apple will go. I'm sure they're testing both, though.
It'll be right center console for the Apple Card in 2018.
Let's see.
Let's make sure we note that there are some big pain in the butt things about it, including that one and only one port. I'm going to be, as Ren mentioned, we're both going to be speaking at the Cocoa Conference in Yosemite next week, and now I'm really am excited about using this as my only computer, and I was trying to work out the problem of, oh man, how am I going to drive a presentation from this, and can I spend $70 my mind has been so ingrained into the idea that video is something you plug a cable into, I forgot that, well, you could just take an Apple TV and use AirPlay and have that as a wireless thing. So it really is a machine that tries to browbeat you in a positive way into adapting the way that you work to work around the limitations of what you have. Renee, are you worried about the CPU? What was your experience using this really not terribly impressive, let's say, CPU? Fanless?
Yeah, it's Core M, which was codenamed Broadwell Y previously, and it's a super low power chip, and I don't think Apple has used them before, though other vendors have, but it's roughly analogous to maybe a 2011 MacBook Air, but a lot of people still use those, and those are still practical machines. It's just, I recently switched from a MacBook Air to a MacBook Pro because I was on the road so much, and I do use Final Cut. I don't know, some people, you know, they want to use Handbrake or they want to use Xcode, and they want to do things that are high performance, and this is not the laptop for that. That's why Apple makes the MacBook Pro. And you know, there's data out there about how many people actually plug into external displays and a lot of peripherals, and it's not many, but for those people, it's why Apple left them. And I do use Final Cut. I don't know, some people, you know, they want to use Handbrake or they want to use Xcode, and they want to do things that are high performance, and this is not the laptop for that. It's why Apple makes the MacBook Pro. And you know, there's data out there about how many people actually plug into external displays and a lot of peripherals, and it's not many, but for those people, it's why Apple left the MacBook Air on the market. So I think this, you really have to know your use cases. And for a lot of people, I was joking about this before, but during the event, I got a text, and people were like, only one port, I don't have to worry about what to plug in where anymore. That's a huge stress reliever for me. And as someone who's plugged USB into MagSafe before and had the computer shut down, I kind of appreciate where they're coming from. This really is almost like iPad level simple.
More plastic.
Yep. It's Alex, the question I want to ask you about this sort of stuff, though,
it
is,
was not plastic.
I like the fact that Apple has decided to not replace anything.
It was a wire.
It's clear
that's
that
supposed
at some point
to be
the MacBook Air line is going to age out of the system, and then when people are ready for a one-port or two-port computer, this is going to replace it in sometime in the next 2 years, 2 or 3 years, but there's going to be sort of a handoff period between the two. But as somebody who travels with computers and you have to do pretty intense stuff, is there like sort of a benchmark for you as to how you trade off something that's super light and portable and it's easy to get from job to job versus something that you're not willing to compromise tech specs for?
Yeah, I mean, I have to admit that I carry both. So I have, you know, I think of my little 11-inch Air as kind of the little shuttle that comes out of the Enterprise. So when I'm, you know, I have a Retina, at least one of them, usually in my backpack that I can, that I'm really doing work on for the most part. Whether, you know, jumping into visual effects or Final Cut or whatever. And then the little one is just where I put in a small bag that I can, you know, walk around and still know that I can get connected. I think that the problem for me is that, I, unlike you, I'm very much addicted to my MagSafe life kits. And I may have frozen here, so we'll see if you can...
Oh, dear.
Lost.
Lost in Vegas. Okay. Sounds like
Vegas.
A good time. Yeah, sounds like a good time as any to go to a commercial. We were going to reach out to the dim past, the grim specter of Leo Laporte from an age-old time with this message from Audible. Thanks, Andy. We're going to interrupt just for a little bit so I can tell you about Audible.com. They're back to more of Mac Break Weekly. I mean, Andy's a huge Audible fan. We all are. We love listening to audiobooks on Audible. I win in terms of the longest Audible subscriber. I started subscribing, I think, February 2000. You know, you can look. One of the nice things about Audible is all of your books are always visible online and downloadable. So it's kind of like your library. Right now I'm listening to Becoming Steve Jobs, The Evolution of a Reckless Upstart into a Visionary Leader. It's actually great. We've been talking about that.
And of course, the birds we need to fly, and that sort of thing. We need to have wings that can flap and so on.
Fiction and non-fiction, lots of great science fiction.
This is not one.
Other land, which John Slonin has recommended. So this is my first Audible book. Yeah, February 7th, 2000. So I've been an Audible member now for more than 15 years. It is a lifesaver. Can you believe that? It is a lifesaver. I started listening to Audible when I was commuting to the screensavers. I had a two-hour commute, sometimes 2 hours each way, depending on traffic. And Audible may get me from going crazy. In the car, at the gym, walking the dog, washing the dishes. Lisa and I both listen to Audible all the time. And you know, there's so much choice. 150,000 different titles. So here's what I'm going to do for you. I'm going to get you your first title. Go to audible.com/MacBreak. Audible.com/MacBreak. You're going to sign up for the gold account. That's a book a month. See, I don't know how this would be beginning Python programming. Let's listen. I'm just curious.
But in the programming book. In the near future, we will, from now on, and a while.
Oh, see, I want to hear the
forward. I will concentrate on doing, getting a lot of these loose ends finished.
All right, I'm gonna have to give it a try. I like to listen to, what I do is I alternate fiction and nonfiction. So right now, listening to Steve Jobs' book. I'm gonna go into the Other Land series. It's my next book. One of my favorite books of all time, Cryptonomicon. I have it in savings. I'm saving it for a moment when I need a break. I need to be uplifted. There's some old Laszlo Bock's workhorse is supposed to be amazing. The HR guy at Google is supposed to be incredible.
And start building.
So here's the deal. Audible.com/MacBreak to sign up for the gold account.
Landscape. That's
funny, little thing
we need. Sorry.
Back to Mac Break Weekly, Andy and Upco.
Like your voice from the past, Alex. Leo. Before we leave the new MacBook, two quick notes. One, that it seems to be shorted just the same way as the watches have. They're supposed to be on sale starting on Friday, but if you go to the Apple Store, you're going to have to wait about 4 weeks for your delivery to arrive. And also, while listening to Leo tell us about Audible, I said, hey, I wonder what happens when you use force press on the outliner, and it crashed on the outliner. So clearly there's going to have to be some people updating.
Taking a lid off. a little up and then we put a little on again. That's how it works. You don't want it to look like a dog.
Last week I was 8.3 long feature list as usual, the kinds that some leave out.
Those lines are more fluid and soft, where this one is a little more rough, a little more.
Now there is same-sex couples represented as families. It's little stuff like this that actually is, it's when you improve these finer points of the experience of using something, that's when you really get a big smile on your face. what else is in there? I mean, is it? I did read that there was some. It was breaking Touch ID for some people, but I'm not having a problem with it. Ray, have you heard of anything? Any reason not to update to 8.3?
No, yeah, some people did have a Touch ID problem, but if you disabled it, rebooted it, re-enabled it, it would come back.
It's MacBreak Weekly, I hear, on the Twit network. If anyone wonders.
When there is a new iOS update, you then have to launch the app that holds extension, type in your password, and authorize that. Mostly it's with one password. You gotta put in your master password, then it re-enables Touch ID for all your apps. And I think some people, we reboot so rarely now that people forget about that but it also adds a ton of security stuff, which was I was really happy to see.
Yeah, and those I was looking at the list yesterday or over the weekend, and they were the usual esoteric stuff that doesn't look like.
And they have like Windows Weekly and Google. What? This week in Google and lot of good stuff. One more fun thing about a cormorant, that when they are in water, they get wet. Not like a dog. The feathers, if you, in the winter, when you see a cormorant in the water, then they often stand up on the ice with their wings out to the side. That's when they try to dry up or dry out. Because they get wet, their feathers don't reject the water like normal seabirds do. It's really a fun bird in many, many respects.
Just how much I hate working with the music app. in terms of, it's just, it's hard. It's, the organization is difficult, especially if my car is only integrated with Bluetooth, so it's very hard for me to quickly search for songs. And the only way that I can try and get things to work is usually by
come over here. Close to me.
I don't know. I have some oil
here. Even
off of that as well. I was trying to make a playlist the other day for a roller derby thing. And when I was trying to make this playlist, I'm like, okay, I have these songs. And I go to add songs. And some songs, you tap on them, and they just won't add. And it's not an iTunes match error, because I was adding songs that I hadn't personally downloaded to my iPhone, but just some songs wouldn't add. Just no idea why. So it's just little bits here and there. Organization. I love Beats, so I'm really kind of hoping that Beats' custom playlists, as well as some of their technology, is either integrated into iTunes Radio or replaces iTunes Radio. It would be real swell.
Yeah, I've now, for to save all of us, I've pulled up the article from 9to5Mac. So we're just quoting 9to5Mac here. quote, and 9to5Mac quotes the release note saying that it has an all new design, a beautiful new design that makes exploring a music collection easier and more fun.
And for those of you who have children, then tomorrow we have Kids Workshop. So remember that one. We are building a dollhouse with I'm building it with my granddaughter. I have not gotten as far with it as I wished, but because I have had all this stuff to do, but you make it, and it's a doll castle more than it is a doll house. I think it's a fun project to have with your grandkids or your own kids or whatever, some quality time together. So every Wednesday I get my granddaughter down in the kindergarten and just after midday, and then we have a nice day together. And on Friday I have her big brother. And we make Minecraft stuff and whatnot. And so
theoretically continue listening to where you left off. Exactly, but it hasn't been updated.
Coffee are cold, so we will get some.
Because I really want that feature. Apple, it should be so easy. Why is it not?
You ever get the sense that you're walking through like a house that is only 1 month away from getting its occupancy permit, because you can see the
heat. That was better.
Many great components that are just waiting to be hooked up, and then one switch flipped,
saying that about the music app for the past 2 years, probably, which is why that all my music is now in Google Play or Amazon. Other updates, though, I've got an update to Final Cut, which dropped just yesterday. Alex, I think I'm going to ask
move
you,
it out a little.
I'm guessing you know more about Final Cut than I do.
Yeah, so, you know, it's sort of a got release update, but there's some really interesting things that are in it. Now, there's some basic stuff that's kind of more technical, supports some different support for Red, Raw, as well as being able to open more than one scope. I think that those are things that
we need.
You
can see the wings are a little thick on this side and this side.
Text. So, you know, and it's really more than just 3D text, it's a 3D renderer that's inside of Motion in Final Cut. And I think that, you know, there's a lot of performance, a lot of underlying bits and pieces, but one of the things about this is that they've really kind of experimented with making it a lot easier for the average person to, you know, use, you know, 3D text. And I think that, you know, my guess is, of course, this is kind of a dip in that pool. So so what you can do now is you know, you can have your text there and you can select a little selector that says, I would like this to be 3D. And
symmetry.
Now it's extruded. And
that's the name of the game.
Is, you know, guys like me are used to, like, really setting up all the materials and putting it all together. And Apple did what Apple does, which is they simplified everything. So they said, you know, you can do metal or plastic or stone or wood or concrete, and you can even add layers. You can add extra substances on top of them. But they really stopped talking about surface attributes, you know, specular versus diffuse versus reflectivity, and really just went shininess and thickness, and we're going to add these things. And at first, when I first turned it on, I was like, oh, well, this is a good idea. You kind of feel like, as someone who does 3D, you feel like you can't get a hold of everything the way you want to. But as I've started to play with it a bit more, I think that for the average editor and for a motion designer, this is going to be great. I think we're going to see a lot of really interesting things with it. So I think that is, you know, and you can do things like, for instance, it only handles text right now, but you can, if you went into a font editor, take your logo and make it A. Yeah. You know, and then you can extrude your logo out. So there's a little bit of a you know, roundabout way to bring your own graphics in. It's still just a straight extrusion. It's not whole 3D models, but it's all connected in there. It looks great. I mean, the renders look really nice. There's a lot under the hood there that you can really get into. So I think that was the big thing that they added for there. There's some other things that are interesting around the compressor that kind of let you, you know, deal with a variety of issues that you would need to publish more effectively to iTunes, which I think, you know, could be really interesting if that's becoming more widely available. You know, that might be a precursor to things in the future. You know, I don't know that for sure, but it definitely is interesting that they're making more.
Okay.
Is that Apple has basically an entire vertical market, all the way from when you're creating content to when you're watching it on TV, and they've never felt like, kind of like what you were talking about with, you know, all these things not being quite hooked up, you never feel like that pipeline is completely, and probably on purpose, completely connected, but it feels like they might be connecting that a little bit. So,
How important is it that they've improved support for compressor inside the app itself? Have they added, taken features from the compressor app and put it inside Final Cut, or is it just an integration thing?
You know, I believe that there have been some additions of taking some of the compressor.
For you, it looks like it's tinted, but it's not. It's the lens distortion, pillow distortion on the lens when you get that close. If you
like
boops,
so,
this way,
but the, so I haven't tested it that heavily.
And then the camera is on an angle, it comes off like
conversation, because I don't do that ever, so I don't really hold.
It looks like it's ready to fall, but it is not.
I'm out of Final Cut,
it's straight up and down.
So that if anything goes wrong with the compression, I have my file, then I'm now working with that. I'm not opening a Final Cut every time I want to, you know, to recompress something. So I have to admit, I've never been a very good tester of that, of those tools of being able to compress straight out of Final Cut, because I kind of have a religious, you know,
I try to figure out how to make it work, because I'd much rather have better, when I do videos, I'd much rather have higher qualities, lower file size. But it really is, it's for somebody with, I don't know, 9 years of IT technical institute plus post-graded. Yeah, exactly. Is it just never intended for somebody who is not a professional in the video field and a high level professional to use?
I have to admit that I've been using Compressor since pretty much day one, or a little before day one. And so for me, it's always been there was a big jump when they went to 10, where there was a big interface change. But for me, it's always been kind of incremental, so I don't think I notice it as much. I think that there's oftentimes just with QuickTime, I used to just have little QuickTime settings that I would still use to get something out. I think that the big advantage of Compressor is that you do have a lot of control. The problem you really get into is with great power comes great responsibility, and so I think a lot of people have trouble. There's so many little buttons in there that you can grab onto, and you can really mess up your files. I don't really use any of the presets that are in Compressor, so I have my own little presets that are my there's like upload to YouTube, upload fast to YouTube, which is slightly different compression setting, and so I have a couple of a lot of different things that I use for outputs. I think that you do have to have a little bit, if you're going to open up Compressor, you have to have a little knowledge of how compression works and what you're doing to your file. It also, there's a lot of management issues. One of the big advantages of Compressor is it is blindingly fast on the newer Macs. I mean, I can remember back in the day when we were talking about the compression time being 2 minutes for every 1 minute of content, and now it's like 10 seconds for every 1 minute of content. I mean, Compressor is incredibly fast on the modern architectures, and because of that, I use it all the time just because I don't want it. I used to think QuickTime, you'll get something relatively good out of it, but the old QuickTime 7. And now I'm fairly, the compressor, and I think that Final Cut will do this.
Okay, but now, since we're on Final Cut, though, do you think that pros are, is Apple making pros happy with Final Cut now? Is the mutiny of a few years ago kind of over with and forgotten, or have the people who are going to leave already left?
Hold on to that question. Just dropped.
Okay.
That dramatic pause at the end of his statement was, in fact, the connection suddenly dropping off.
Red, do you have anything that you'd like to jump in and say about Final Cut before we go on to photos?
As a former film editor, it's hard for, I really like using Final Cut Pro 10. I like 7 as well. I feel like 10 made it much easier to do some things and more obtuse to do others. But I can't I can't answer the Exodus question, because I'm no longer really actively working in film, and I can't be like, I'm not going to speak on behalf of other people. But it certainly feels like the drama and the fervor has kind of died down a little bit. People are either quietly switching to Final Cut Pro 10, or the people who are using, continuing to use Avid, continuing to use Premiere, other apps that better suit their needs.
And I think that, sorry, I brought that again. I think that the interesting thing about it is that I talked to a lot of folks who, folks that are really, that were high-end film guys that were using Final Cut went back to Avid or went to Premiere. But there's this huge group of people that have entered the Final Cut, and I think they're kind of invisible to a lot of people because they're not the guys working on Conan O'Brien or whatever, but they are just average folks that just want to get their edits done, and I think that a lot of people are finding that it's just a lot faster and easier to put that together. And so the things that are big pluses, of course, is that it's $300. It's not a subscription. It is not, we haven't paid for an upgrade since it was released. If you're an average person kind of putting that stuff together, that's pretty compelling. Once you get used to using it, I have to say that it's very non-linear editor since 1983, so it was definitely a process for me to kind of get into that, but it's, Final Cut's so much faster. Non-linear editor since 1983, so it was definitely a process for me to kind of get into that, but Final Cut's so much faster than most work done that, by the time I would normally files, I'll have the edit, you know, largely done. And so it's just very hard to, like, especially for journalists or anyone trying to do anything with it that are fast turns. Like, to me, when they say they're using something else, I kind of internally just go, well, how's that working for you?
More plastic. You shall never send it close to your models.
Renee, is that the official release? It's officially out of beta now?
Yep, photos for OS 10 and iCloud Photo Library, all of them out of beta and into your life.
I should have guessed because iMore has a wonderful multi. The artistic beard and say, you know, my needs for photo editing far surpassed those of a consumer-oriented editing option. I mean, there are things I understand about light and feels and emotion that I don't think that simply pushing sliders around in a free app are going to do. So obviously, you and Ren have been spending a lot of time with photos. Will somebody who wants to do more than tweak brightness and contrast have a lot of fun with photos, or is it really going to be, here's your excuse for moving to Lightroom now that Aperture has been killed?
So I really let Ren handle the bigger picture. My quick take is, because I'm an Aperture user too, but I would say 50% of my Aperture use was right-click edit in Photoshop, because I'm just way more used to Photoshop. And this is similar to me. I can get away with using photos because right now there's a one-click send to Aperture button. So anything that even if it's just, I could do it, but I don't know how, and I don't want to spend the time learning, I just send it to Aperture. So right now I feel like we're in a really safe place, Andy. We don't have to make any hard choices yet, but there's a lot to like. And like I said, Ren's been spending a lot of time on that part of it.
Yeah, Ren, I mean, I've been starting to learn Lightroom because I know that at some point I'm going to have to know how to use it better, and also I didn't want to start the investment in photos. Do you think that I'd be better off trying to learn how to build the workflows for photos, or is it a limited option, do you think, for editing?
I really think it depends on your needs. I've used Photos for Mac since the first developer beta came out. And I am of the opinion that if you are anything under a frequent prosumer, which is to say that you have a DSLR and you take a lot of really awesome photos on vacation, or you wander around, say, the Boston Common and take a lot of photos, I think actually any of those use cases on down to super beginner, you'll actually really like Photos. Because Photos has those super basic sliders, yes, but those super basic sliders can turn into much more complicated sliders and get yourself additional widgets like levels, contrast and brightness, a histogram so that you can see where your colors are being integrated. It really, again, I feel like it's your personal use case and it really depends, but what I would suggest is if you're interested in at least playing around with photos and seeing if it's potentially good for your use case, take 500 to 1,000 photos or even just one batch of photos and create a tiny photos library that isn't connected to iCloud Photo Library. Just make yourself a demo photo. Library and play around with the editing tools. It's a free program and it comes installed as part of OS 10, so it's not like you're losing money or really time to give it a quick whirl and test through. And if you don't like what it has, or if it doesn't currently suit your needs, then you don't have to use it. I do think that from a management perspective, and especially when you incorporate iCloud Photo Library, if having your photos available to you from any device is important to you, photos is a must-have. And the editing process.
One of the problems when I do this.
Very annoying for me, and it's something that I really hope that they fix in future versions.
Half finished stuff is that. It stand around so long that
the cumbersome it, process of taking the photo, exporting the photo out and editing in Photoshop.
It takes it gets a little.
You want to be able to carry around all of your images.
Kind of.
The fact that I now have a 15,000 photo library.
Destroyed, or shall we say, it's.
In photo I want.
Get moved around a lot, and then the.
Comes
errors in it. And then you have to do it again. You get a lot of double work when you don't finish it at once when you are at it.
I think that's important in my photo.
So.
This review, so I don't want to take the entirety of MacBreak Weekly on going on and on about photos. But
it is best when you are. Get it finished every time.
On down, I think it's great. If you're a professional photographer, you will be unhappy with photos. It is not Aperture. It is not Lightroom. It is not designed to be Aperture or Lightroom. Apple may fix some things. I really hope it fixes some things. I hope it adds some more brushes than its tiny little retouch button. I hope it adds edit, you know. No edit in an external editor rather than just this weird add to Aperture button. But for the time being, I think it's a remarkably stable 1.0 release, and I feel like a great number of people will be very happy with it. Professionals? No, you still gotta either use Aperture or Lightroom. I'm sorry about that, but it doesn't seem like like, this Apple is not solving your dilemma. Apple is not positioning photos as an Aperture replacement a la Final Cut Pro 10, being like, I know it's kind of loosey-goosey, but we'll fix it later. No, they're like, this is the photo editing.
As though in killing Aperture. And one of the things that was on my mind is, well, maybe they're actually saying that the new framework is not just this Photos app, it really is a whole architecture for photos on every single device that Apple makes. Maybe they're saying that you'll be able to do as much with Photos plus maybe a $30 or $40 plugin that a third party will come up with as you could with Aperture or Lightroom or anything else you'd like to use. So I do have the developer build. I've been trying it a little bit, but certainly not as intensively as you have. So I guess the other big question for myself and so many other people, Ren, can I trust giving it one of my Aperture libraries or my iPhoto library, or do I? My instinct is I'm going to create a copy of my Aperture library on my current MacBook. I'm going to put it on a flash drive and I'm going to mail it to myself by route of Kazil to make sure it's 3,000 miles away before I show photos this library. Is there, what's the worst that can happen? Okay, let's not say the worst that can happen is that asteroids kill us all while we're trying to get my photos loaded in. But realistically, can I feel as though I can trust photos with my existing libraries?
Yeah, well, so the number one concern that you have that photos might otherwise destroy.
I'm using photos and now I can't open up an Aperture and stuff
so
like that.
So when photos looks at your Aperture and your iPhoto library, it doesn't actually convert it. So you actually can still keep on using Aperture with that original library that you made way back when, or iPhoto with your original iPhoto library, even after you have converted the library. Because it's actually not converting it. It's making a hard like a second copy with hard links, which basically allow it to take up the same amount of storage space, despite the fact that theoretically your hard drive thinks that it's taking up twice as much storage space, but it's not actually from an overall picture. It's just sharing the data in between libraries, so that if you're, you know, you can still keep on editing in Aperture, you can keep on editing in Photos, but your management is entirely separate. They're two separate libraries. Something you do in Photos will not reflect in Aperture and vice versa. But if you delete your Aperture library, or if you delete your Photos library, your Aperture library is still fine, or your Photos library is still fine. It's not going to destroy one or the other. It's not a symbiotic relationship. You can part them if you want, or you can keep them together on the the same hard drive and run them side by side, even if you wanted to. It's not a huge problem. In general, I feel like it's totally worth getting, giving the risk, taking the jump and just being like, I'm going to test this out. And if it's awful, I will just delete the photos library and then whatever. Then we're cool. Or honestly, I know a couple people, friends of mine who are doing this, who are
it sounds like they have problem with their Ustream stream. It's come and goes all the time. Connection. This
that was me too. Look at I do feel like if you have a gigantic library, you may need to look into upgrading. I know some people's hesitancy is it's like, oh God, I don't want to pay for another storage plan. And I feel that because I'm already paying for Dropbox.
To leave you a second.
design stuff. They have the best designers. Now, let me explain what Squarespace is. It's not just a hosting company. When you get started at Squarespace, you will get choose your first template. They've got some gorgeous... tell you in a little bit why these templates are extra special. Let's just pick one out. You'll set up your first site. You can do this, by the way, absolutely free. You don't need to give them a credit card or anything. For 2 weeks, you've got the site, you've got the hosting, you've also got the software running on top of it. And there's a real advantage to doing it this way. Because Squarespace runs this.
I do too love Squarespace. My site is a Squarespace site. I think this is ridiculous. I think we go to Big Gravity instead.
It's like Monday, April 12th, 20th at 5 p.m.
See? No lag there. It's Ustream. That have troubles. Low on power. Just before I started this streaming. My keyboard needed new batteries. And it was just after I restarted. I could.
Given the historical nature of WWE, it used to be where the San Francisco is on lockdown. If you
click enter on it. So I thought, wow, the computer was wrong, but it was batteries on the keyboard. Something like this. We don't have any sharp edges.
Stuck in the same kind of like iPhone to iPhone 3G limbo, only it's a little bit better than last time because we're not limited to web apps. These handheld apps are actually pretty cool featured and pretty awesome, and they can store a certain amount of info direct on the watch so that you, you know, you can still use the app even if your iPhone is not necessarily directly by your side. But I don't know. I'm kind of up in the air on whether or not we'll see it at this year's WWDC or we'll see it during next year.
Yeah, not to reopen watch, but that's something that's been on my mind a lot. That I kind of found in a Twitter storm two days before pre-orders started, by sort of saying maybe you want to consider not pre-ordering this one, knowing that it would be great advice for anybody who was looking for advice, and the people that are the best audience for the first generation don't care what anybody says, pro or con, they're going to buy it anyway. Because I'm with you. I think it's going to be like the first iPhone, like the first iPad, where there's going to be a lot of stuff coming up. And I feel as though there's a lot of stuff coming up in 2016 that the first generation won't have the hardware to handle. Although it'd be hard to imagine Apple not having native watch apps, at least in time for the Christmas buying season, when I hope they'll have enough stock on hand. Alex, is there anything that Apple could possibly announce at WWDC, or at least tip their hand to, that would be really, really welcome news to you? I'm trying to, when I heard about WWDC this morning, I was kind of like making a mental list of, here are all the rumored things that we've been hearing about, things that are picking up velocity, that would need developer support, and Apple would either
because we don't want,
first truck this week. I loved it so much I got another truck. By the way, this costs nothing. You don't pay for the shipping or returns. You don't pay for Robin's time. You only pay for what you keep. That's it. So I haven't opened this yet. It's gonna be my first time. This is the biggest truck. This one's really big. They do such a nice job that you'll be so excited when your truck arrives.
I can't remember what we... Oh, wait, I got on sideways. There we go.
I can't remember what we told her this time. So one of the nice things they do is they give you an envelope with return mailing. Nicely and everything. Great stuff. Oh, my gosh. Okay, I'm definitely keeping that. Probably not that. This is nice. This is like a pea coat. Well, I can't wait to try that on. So here's the deal. You're going to try all this stuff on. You're going to see if you like it. Anything you don't like, you just put throw back in the trunk, send it back. They pay the shipping. This is a return shipping envelope. You only pay for the stuff you keep. If you keep nothing, you pay nothing. And we asked her for some neckties. This, oh, I love this. Look at that. Isn't that beautiful? All right, we're keeping that for sure. I love this one, too. Beautiful shirts, sweaters, but it'll all depend. You know, this is my stuff. It all depends on what you say. Oh, look at that. See, the nice thing is I don't know what's trending hip. Robin does. So if Robin sends me a bright red tie, I know people will wear it. That will look good. I should wear this to my presentation. Should I? All right. You got a presentation in Vegas. That's why I'm not here.
Here, I just hold it up here, and you might have heard that little. So anyway, that helps you.
sitting at the table, you know, and you put it on, you know, and it's a, it is kind of the next generation of selfie, because it's a selfie, you know, you've had ones that are front and back, you know, where you get the two photos. This is like you, you know, talking to someone, and like picture with them and everything that you were standing inside of at the same time. I will like to say in my own defense that I did order black and somehow I ended up with pink, but I needed it, so I kept it. So anyway, I did, you know, I've done stuff like I suction cupped it to the front of my car, which makes a really odd experience in a Gear VR, because it feels like you're sitting on the hood of the car. So
what can you do with the video? Is it like a standard, it records a standard video file?
It creates a video file that is, that's two halves, and then their software will stitch it together. And their player will do it. There's some players online that are capable of playing it, but you can see, yeah, there's someone who took it. And what's really interesting, look at it, it looks like you're just pinching. It looks like you're just holding up your hand, and it maps itself out of the picture.
Clean your thumbnail first.
You know, I do regret that I bite my nails now. Like, keep on looking at these photos, and they're like, oh man, that's rough. So, but you know, it's got a 420 on the bottom so that you can mount it to tripods and, you know, do all that other fun stuff. So there's a lot of other things that you can kind of get it away from yourself. That's probably a better solution. And it's just, I'm really, you know, really enjoy it. You know, if like, this is where I was, this is like the whole, you know, there's some good examples there. Anyway, it's good.
Yeah, it's, how much is it? Alex.
Oh! Now we don't know whether we could.
At least.
Exactly.
We will find out how much we can if we don't get Alex back. Until then, Renee, what you got for us?
So, I have had a long and abiding love for an app called Snapseed. It's on iOS and Android. It was by Nix Software, and they got bought by Google. And Google's a big company, and I understand they can't always put all their attention everywhere that I'd like it all the time. They sort of left it to for a long time, felt like years and years, and it just sort of got older and older, and I used it less and less. Well, finally, and I'm going to use the full-on italic bold version of finally, they've released version 2.0 of Snapseed. I think it was last week, and it is awesome. I haven't used it on Android yet, but on iOS especially, it is terrific, most of all because they actually took the time, they actually cared enough to implement PhotoKit, which is Apple's API that lets you tie into the non-destructive edit pipeline that iOS 8 introduced. So theoretically, you can do stuff in Photos, you can do stuff in all the different filters in Photos, and you can do stuff in Snapseed, and then if you later change your mind, it's not, oh, I have to go back to the original and painstakingly reproduce this entire chain of events, except changing that one step that will lead me to a better, brighter future. But you can just go in and twist the knobs and dials and change just the part that you originally changed with Snapseed. The downside is not everything, including some of Apple's stuff, doesn't support the non-destructive edit pipeline yet, but Photos does, and for a lot of people, that's their primary way of getting all sorts of pictures on iOS and OS X, and I just couldn't be happier. It is, I don't know if it's a complete rewrite, and I don't know if John Knapp was specifically involved, but I feel like when he arrived there at Google, Adobe magic things started to happen.
Yeah, he's been really active that way. I'm sorry, Ren, you're about to say? I'm sorry,
no, I didn't say anything.
Okay.
I'm just listening in contentment.
Second, basking.
Yeah, it's just as usual.
As usual, basking in the Renee wisdom. But so long as we've got the camera swung around here. Brenda, what do you got for us?
All right. So.
Laptop and a
super side pocket that will fit a 10-inch iPad. And all of that is easy access right on the side, so if you're going through a lot of airports, you don't have to open your bag and dig through all your stuff for your laptop, which I love. I had never seen this on a backpack until I picked this up, and I know that lots of backpacks have it, but it was still one of those, like, my mind is blown! It has these, like, all of the zippers to expand or contract the backpack. It has a top zipper here where you can put front things. I have, like, an iPhone cable just in case, and I can use a battery pack in there as well. On the bottom, I haven't even opened the bag yet. On the bottom, there's this little pouch, which will fit a DSLR with a 40mm pancake lens in it, and it's actually the perfect place to hide a DSLR because it's, again, easy access, and it's padded. And then, you open up the backpack itself, there's another zipper pocket here, where you can put, like, pens, and I've got more cables. It comes with a cable organizer, and it has giant bag space for...
It comes with cable organizers.
And more.
Wow.
And, you know what, I never knew that this was important until I found it on this backpack. It has a handle on the inside, so if you have the bag open and it's on the floor, you can pick it up and dig through it while you're still holding it without having to be like, oh, where is that? Where can I charge my phone or my computer?
It's also awesome that the lining is like a bright color. It's not black, so it must be easier to find things inside there too.
Yeah, I really like it. So it's, I only got it for, I think, $120. So it's not even, you know, super, super expensive for a nice backpack. And it's made out of the same materials. That's a great herringbone, which I feel like it looks really classy. It doesn't look like your average geek backpack. And it does have that nice sort of neon interior. But it's also, it's made with the same kind of, like, high-quality construction materials that you'd find in a hiking backpack, so you don't have to worry about it ripping, and there are extra clips and snaps if you're putting on something just particularly heavy. And that top cover-over that holds the main compartment in it can be expanded or contracted as necessary. So I've stuffed things up, like I had a bedroll in there. I could theoretically go hiking with this backpack and have tech stuff, which is pretty cool. I used it extensively when I was in Ireland, and I really, really liked it. So that's my hardware thing. My software thing is more of a quick shout-out. So I forget who mentioned this game to me. I have become addicted to a Japanese cat game, which I think Tiffany and Mark Orment are to blame for this, because Tiff was talking about it in Ireland, and then I went for it. It's called, I think, Niko Atsume. The game is entirely in Japanese, so the first time I saw it, I'm like, this is insane, I don't understand what to do, but it is adorable. It's basically, you put out things, you buy little, like, food and cardboard boxes and other random things, and then little tiny cats come to visit you from, who knows, neighboring environments. And they come and they play with your toys, and then they leave you sardines as gratitude. And it's like, it's this little, you know, it's set it and forget it. You just go back every so often and you put down little things. But all of the cat animations are so cute. There's, like, one of the cats is playing with a ball and it just teetles back and forth. They're just, they're really well designed. It's a really well designed, very adorable little game. It's total like, it's totally something that I've just enjoyed.
If we were really smart, we would make a... We would make a cat animated movie.
It's like, I have to check this every 5 seconds, and the cat will die. But this one, it's like...
But we are not.
In and out. They're not yours. You can take pictures of them.
Like a real cat.
Yeah, exactly. It's the cat is not at your beck and call. It is not there to amuse you. It just happens to enjoy itself, and you can occasionally peek in on its delight. So it's my perfect, like, happy time app. So I'm gonna recommend that to everybody. I'm so sorry in advance, because it is kind of addicting. There are in-app purchases, but you can totally get away with not doing them at all. It's just, again, just playing with adorable cats.
That's not a bad thing at all. Do we have Alex back?
No, he's dropped. He's not coming back, although I will tell you, just to kind of round up his review of the Ricoh Theta, it's $300.
Okay,
okay, it's not too bad.
Yeah.
And for collecting stuff that you can't collect otherwise, I had a 160 something degree lens for like my Nikon Coolpix 990, and I was showing off my at my parents' house. Oh, here's how well this camera works. And my parents had never seen a digital camera before. And then like only 2 or 3 years ago, I came across those just stupid pictures I took just to show it off. Like, oh, I have 360 degree views of my mom and dad's living room. Oh, I have 360 degrees. Views of the kitchen, and there's a time when you're going to be an older fool, and like, you know, your parents are going to be gone, and your parents' house is going to be sold, or events are going to be long, long gone, and maybe, oh, look, it's just like being there again, isn't this lovely? I don't have to decide where to point the camera. So that's pretty cool. My pick is a free piece of software that I discovered last week. A lot of us are using if this then that really cool like web app that does like internet rules.
Experience, including matching the sport with different bands, including the Milanese Loop. I'm going to write later on why I'm choosing a 38mm over a 42mm watch. I know a lot of people are having kind of a discussion who haven't been able to try it on yet. Well, do I need the small one? Do I need the big one? What's going on? We've got a buyer's guide out there. All kinds of other fun things. I'm going to be continuing to write photos how-tos because even after the 55-plus how-tos we wrote for iMore, people are coming in with questions, and I'm like, oh, yeah, that's actually a great point. Let me explain how to do that for, instead of trying to fit it into 140 characters, let's make this an actual post. So a lot of photos, triage, some Apple Watch stuff, I'll probably bump, I did a guide on playing Hearthstone that just hit on the iPhone right now, and I know that's a secret guilty pleasure for me and quite a few other people, so if you're interested in that, I'm sure you can find that on iMore.com, just all of the things.
Awesome. Serenity and I and Jason Snell and Jim Dalrymple and a whole bunch of legitimately cool people are going to be at the Yosemite Coco Conference next week.
One more. Plastic.
I'm going to go for every single closet and get every single camera that I can to see that. I'm going to be finishing up my MacBook Pro review soon. I've got two or three other things in the hopper. I've got another Apple Watch piece coming in. I'm trying to be a little bit more discreet about Apple Watch because it's like you start. I think I have 9 things to say about it, and I've already said 7 of them, so I got to make sure that the remaining 2, I really put it out there when it creates a blast with Grace Impact. Leo Laporte will be back with us next week. Until then, thank you so much for watching this week, and get back to work! Brick time is over! Go, bricks! You got time to lean, you got time to clean! Didn't realize I was paying you to Facebook. Hope you're doing a good job of it, and I'm giving you $14 an hour to do it.
Nice.
Well, that's here. I think people have been having that sort of lull sort of conversation for an hour and a half, and now they're going to be pulling their car around a tree because I started yelling.
So Alex is at the Caesar's Buffet now. Is that what we're all thinking?
he is using his tactical pants lined with aluminum foil to really break the bank at the buffet.
Nice. All right, good work, you guys. I made notes of the few dropouts for the editor, so that those, all 4 of them, I think will clean up pretty nicely, so shouldn't be too difficult. We do need a title, though. Anybody in chat room that wants to throw out?
Yeah. By the way, I love those Osprey bags, Ren. They stopped making my favorite, which is called the Beer, and it's just the perfect size for an iPad, whatever keyboard, a compact SLR. It's like
that's the one. Yeah, it's the one my friend Brooke has, the Beer. And she's like, you have to get these bags, they're amazing.
And of course they stopped making the Beer. I can't find them anywhere. And they're on my list of, if I see a store that has one, I'm just gonna buy it because when this one wears out, I wanna have another one lined up for it.
I'm kind of glad about the internet in that regard. I feel like I've stockpiled so many things, like old shoes and jackets and styles that I know will just disappear. It's like, no, I like this too much. Don't let it go away.
Why do manufacturers do that? I want to like send them a postcard. They should include a postcard with like the shoes that I buy or the hats, or whatever. Saying, look, I will continue to buy this as long as you continue to make it. I will pre-buy 100 of these if that will help you keep it going. Just keep making the things that I promise to keep buying.
Word.
Jason, we got a title?
Well, monitoring the chat room for them. Photos in the cloud. Watch out. Not sure what that was in reference.
It should have been more racy. They always go for the racy.
Yeah. This is pure fluff. Well, I'm not sure, again, where that came from, but I'm sure.
Maybe the smart editorial comment, I hope.
Who knows? The roller derby watch. Always go straight as well.
Okay.
If need be.
Oh, so this is 450.
So.
This was 450.
Shouldn't we say that is. Okay.
Okay.
See you later, Renee.
You're Renee.
And ready for scan.
Hop out too. Have fun picking titles, guys. Thanks for having me on.
See you, sir.
Thanks, Renee.
Bye bye.
I think so.
See here the fabric.
Okay.
How about blood on the wristband?
Oh, yes. I like that.
Blah, blah, blah. What is that? For an announcement.
We're talking about pre-order sales for the Apple Watch, existing sales for the brand new super skinny MacBook, worries about Photos app, and all kinds of other things we can worry about coming up in WWDC, coming up shortly on Mac Break Weekly.
Yeah, perfect. Okay. Nailed it. All right, cool. Excellent job, sir.
Take Andy, because I'm too irritable to do something right the right way the second time. It's best not to argue with him. Just let him go. It's acceptable.
I did a great job. Great job leading the show today.
Great.
All righty. Have a wonderful afternoon, sir.
You too, Justin.
All right. Take care. Bye. Everybody stand by. We're going to do the transition to security now. Today we'll be led by Mike Elgin along with Steve Gibson, of course. Stop the rerun recording.
So I can keep on and keep on and keep on and keep on. Stop it! So,
just boom. All right, everybody, stand by. We are going to transition.
We will put this aside. So,
he is in Vegas. He'll be back.
Get on with another one.
Thank you.
then I will move this from this screen to another screen. So I can see what I'm doing over here. Or what you are seeing. And we move to this camera. And we will go and make some leaves. I will turn this around and take the mic with me. So we can get room for it. And move this away over here so I can see the screen. This I apologize because I cannot see the chat room from here. Uh. any questions, I will answer afterwards. I need a lot of leaves, and this is silk paper. And I just use scissors to cut them out. You can see here. And the reason I have the screws in, you can see I have put a lot of screws in here, just to get them apart, because they kind of, when I do this, I can separate them. Otherwise, they kind of stick together. Because I cut them out in this way, so they are in layers, pretty close together. Oops. Not the best. To do it on, but now it's what we have on, so we stick with it. And the knife, scalpel. Before, but I will do now. See if it... Don't do that. Not get too eager. Now I destroyed everything. Patience. shouldn't have done it on this cardboard. That was a bad idea. I have a cutting mat I usually use. Turn it around. Idea, but you have to try something new once in a while so you can get it done quicker. Yeah. Maybe we should do like this. This is good enough. No pressure. Next time we will remove this cardboard. And use the cutting mat. God, this is not good. Not so good an idea after all, because first of all I didn't cut through all of them. We will not do that. Okay. Oh, it's out of, totally out of order. That was not what expected. I just wanted to try something else to make it easier, and I managed to make it harder. I think I will take so flimsy, this silk paper. But that's what I do all the way through. Experimenting to try to find some new ways to do it so it can go faster. But a lot of time it ends up like this, and he's really not going any faster, but the opposite. This is so hard. Stop it. This is not working. This is good enough. No, pick. Away with that.
Thank you.
Oh, now I don't know. Can I pull it? The big advantage of this is that I don't have to cut them apart afterwards. As you saw, then I get some other problems. Yeah. And I know you can't get these stamped out. If you make a kind of stencil. You can get a laser cutter so you can cut them out too. But it's all a question of money. I can also get Disney to make the film and then I don't have to bother. But that is not that one. So. I do it myself. doing much to help me. And scissors is dull. I need to sharpen it a little. Well, not tonight. And what better time in the year to make leaves in the spring? So I think it's right. Where is my ear pincher? A little mixed. That wasn't that smart. Yeah. I think this was the most of them. Put this together again. The problem was partly that we cut it on this cardboard. So I didn't get it opened like I should have. At home. That's a really bad idea. I will take some more. Get a little system in it again. It's alive. So, now we have a little hole on it. That's a bad thing. so. Shoot.
Thank you.
Oops. Oh, I have another scissors. Oh. I have English handmade super scissors. So that I got for Christmas. Oh, my son. So let's try that one. Forgotten about that one. It's made in Sheffield. It Wright and Son Limited. It's one of the last places where they make scissors by hand. Like, all the way through. This one is a mass-produced one. This is a handmade one. That is good. And they have them, make them in all shapes and sizes. We had my son had to wait for this one. Order it, and then it came a little later because they have been on the television, BBC, so they certainly, these few guys had an enormous demand on scissors, so that's, they couldn't keep up with the demand. In olden days in England, every little town had scissors a place where they made scissors to the wool production. They they made a lot of clothes back then. They had the
infected because they ended up
like we have a blacksmith and a carpenter and so on. And there also was a guy who made scissors, and that was a very important job at that time. I don't remember, I don't know what he paid for it. They are, of course, a little expensive, but it's something you have forever first to buy it. And I have some big, big ones to cut clothes and that sort of thing. Heavy. Long and short, and to every kind of purpose. And they are beautiful mates. This ended up being a really pain in the rear with this stuff here. Don't lose your cool yet. Not even this separates them all. This was not a good idea. To take this with the Hoover. But that makes too much noise right now. So we will not do that. I will where is my there is I will on a second. I'll be back. And Go back here. See, we need to attach them to this. And the idea is when I made them, I just bent them like this, but with the new method, we do not do that. And if anyone have seen this before, then you remember that I put one single, like on this one. Yup, yup, yup. Here I put one single leaf on at a time. But you can imagine how much time that took. So it took a whole evening to make just one of these. So, but what I tried yesterday and I'll try again today was to do like this. Now there's screws in there, but that don't matter. This glue I found is a glue stick, and you can see it's kind of sticky stuff. So I do like this. I can do it like this. Oh, you cannot see what I'm doing. And then I do like this. And voila! I had to do it over several times, but now I have some will fall off again, but we will let it dry and see. And then I can always put some of them on by hand later to get it to look right. See? Let it dry. I had some I did yesterday. It is good sticky stuff. A little leaf in the process, but I gain many hours. So take this off. Best to let it dry before I start. A little messy now, but that's good enough as this. And then I have to squeeze them a little so they get a little more like the old ones. But that is how I will do it. For now, we'll go back and let those dry and then take the mic over here again. And turn the monitor around if we can without putting anything on the floor. And then we will take the mouse. Come on. Because now I can in really really fast getting some leaves on the trees. And now I don't know if you remember, I will show you. If you see here, oh. You see this tree here, this looks like, this is how they look now, so they have to get sanded and painted, and so they're gonna look like this a little bit. You can see there is difference on them, but more or less the same, but they have to be a little different. But these kind of trees are, what shall we say, they are fill trees, and when the leaves get on them it looks a little like this. We can go out, nope, this way. Move this a little back so you can see. Here's with leaves on. Looks a little like this. I have tumbled that over so many times, so it glued. I have, there's glue all over it, and they fall, they break. And this is the first step. I have another step. And you can see this is how they come out of the printer, because I cannot make them taller than that in the printer. So they come out like this, and then I put a wooden piece of wood in between here, and then I put the crown on, and then it looked like this, and then I paint them like this, and then I put the leaves on like you saw before, like this. So, but these are, as I say, fill trees, and as you see over here, You can see the other trees. Those are different, all of them, individual trees. So, and I need to make more of them also, but now I have to start to build on the table so I can see how many I need and how it looks, and start to kind of model it after the landscape I want to create, where these characters are gonna live. So it's a little it's not possible to just keep on making trees stop after stop without seeing the landscape. I have to create at last, so that's why I do it the way I do it. I have made a lot of other things, figures and animals and stuffs and a lot of different things, birds and rabbits and foot and hands and heads and but I have to, all the stuff I have made until now, I have to start to put together, as I started saying when we started this stream. So that's how it will be, and I will, of course, I will go and get one of those now. Trees like this, I will not scan and print this. I will paint directly on the clay. So this is the final the final tree, and but I will put leaves on this like the other ones. So it's a. Looks like the old oak I want it to be. So, but you can see after a while you have to kind of see where you are at. How many more trees need I to make, because I also need to make some cliffs and some a lake, but it's, I also have to consider the room I have. So as I often have said, I need 600 or 1600 square foot of room, but I have 40, so that's where it has to be. So that means I have to change scenery a lot of times or whatever. I have to come up with solution on it all the time, because I don't have that room. And I have been thinking of branding, but it is so expensive, and I have already put a ton of money into this, so it has to end. And the whole idea with this was, from the start, was if it was possible to make a movie on a shoestring budget. I know it will never be cheap, but you can always get in, at least try to make it much, much, much cheaper than when Disney and big companies make it. And I guess if I can do it, then there is a lot of other people's that can do it, and that will be if I could inspire others to start doing stuff like this. And I know there are a lot of people, you know, or there are some people that do it, and but it's often they start as a little company and at 2-3 guys, and then they get bored and so on, and then the really talented guys, they do get bored. But I hope that will stop at some point, and because diversity makes it really fun, and nowadays you can make it on a low budget, in quotes of course, but if you put your mind to it, it is possible to do it for much less than what the big guys do it for. And then one good thing too is that you can get in contact with a lot of people on the net. You can find the talent around, so it should be possible. At least that's what I'm trying to do. And then time will tell if I was wrong or not. But I don't care, because I have fun while doing it, and I always wanted to do it, so now it has to stand the test. And it will. It will. I just have to make the last texture on this one. I have made the textures on the big trunk here. I need to make it up here too, and I have leaves on my fingers. But when I finish with that, I will paint it on the clay. And then I can put it aside. I wait with painting until I put some leaves on it. And then I have to be able to take that's why I make the leaves as I do with on this thread separately, so I can take it off again, so when we come to fall, I can take all the leaves off the trees and put some other colors leaves on. I cannot do it with light alone, not so it looks real. You could do it computer generated, but I will try to make as little computer generation generating as possible. I want to be as pure pure stop motion handmade as the old guys did it. Not that I have anything against computer generated content, that's fine too, but I think it's kind of have its hope. Oh, we have an insect on our tree. It has its own value and its own look when it's done by hand and it's everything. But I know I use 3D printers and whatnot. It's not because I'm fanatic, but I'm trying to. The 3D printer I use just because I'm alone on the physical part on it. I hope to get people involved on the bits part of it. But right now there is only me, so, and we cannot send, as I have said before, we cannot send physical part around the world, because then it starts to really add cost to it. Then it's no longer low budget, but very expensive. Even more than it is on this state. And of course, I know it keeps adding up all the time, but when I try to keep it as cheap as possible. I have already put something like $100,000 of my own money in it. So it is not. That cheap, but in comparison to what the big companies put in there, then it is really cheap. That's how it is. and I don't know yet how much it will. I will end up putting it. I do buy stuff nearly every day, so the expenses is far more. It's a little difficult to reach all these branches on. But that's how it is. Thank you. nothing to do about it. But I'm really looking forward to start to build the scenery. Lay it out how I want it and how I can make it. Make it in polystyrene. So I can get some levels on it. Some cliffs and little water stream running. So I need a pump or something to pump it uphill and down in the stream and out in the lake. Am I treading on? Maybe I have put some clay on the floor. But I think we are finished for today or tonight, my time. The time near midnight, and I have to load this up, and it takes a while. So, yeah, but oops, there is no. We will be back again tomorrow and And remember, tomorrow we will be back already 3 p.m. to 4 p.m. UTC, plus 1 UTC, and with kids workshop. And then, but until then, I will say thank you for tonight, and we will go to rerun for those who wasn't up yet or was asleep while we was doing this. So good night, and thank you.